greetings, everyone, and it is wonderful to gather together and reflect on, you know, in this Advent season, the hopes as well as the challenges of the COVID-19 situation, but also how we in our diocese are getting ready for Christmas and what we might be learning about life and about faith as we navigate these very difficult times. And so I'm very grateful to be able to join you with four members of our diocese, well known to probably all of you, and maybe I could have them introduce themselves, maybe beginning with Dianne.
I'm Dianne Anderson, and I work in the restorative ministry. It'll be 15 years that I've been doing prison ministry, and I'm enjoying every minute of it.
You're also a member of which parish?
I'm also a member of Our Lady of Guadalupe and one of their elders, one of four elders there.
Okay, well, thank you, Dianne. And next.
I'm Donna. Grew up in a little town called Salvador, been in Saskatoon for many years, married with four kids and 11 grandkids. And I've been part of the diocese forever. Basically since Bishop Manning's days. And then I, 10 years after working, I stopped and had maternity leave and gradually back into full-time.
Oh, thanks. Thanks very much, Donna. Well, let's go out to Foam Lake area.
Hi, my name's Garth McCutcheon. I'm a retired community pharmacist and have been retired for many years now. I'm chairman of our Parish Pastoral Council here at Christ the King Parish in Foam Lake. My wife and I live in a rural setting on Fishing Lake, which is north of the town. And we're just hanging in there like everyone else.
Thank you, Garth.
And my name is Father Ken Beck, and I was born and raised here in Saskatoon, ordained by Bishop James Mahoney in 1975, and for the next 40 years, spent my life primarily in parish ministry. And then after retiring pre-COVID, I was involved in helping priests in parishes on weekends, also part-time chaplain with the Ursulines at Creek Residence, and now living at Columbian Manor and helping out a bit here. But again, things are rather quiet during this COVID time.
Well, thank you. Thanks, Father Ken, and thank you all. My name is Bishop Mark Hagemoen, and it's my pleasure to kind of serve as a bit of an MC for our discussion this morning. Really about COVID-19 and again, how we're getting ready for Christmas, despite the pandemic, and maybe reflecting on some blessings or lessons learned. But maybe we could begin and just open the floor to whoever would like to respond. You know, how has COVID-19 affected you, and how has it affected, in summary, your own kind of work and lifestyle in a summary way? I know it's really affected a lot of people, and it's kind of pulled the carpet out from many people, all the kind of supports and things that they would go to when dealing with any difficulty, crisis, or new thing, even those are taken away. And so if you have a sort of a general reflection on all of this.
I can start if you wish. My wife and I have for many years now gone to Arizona for the winters. And we actually owned a park model trailer in Mesa, Arizona. And last winter when we were there, I got bronchitis pretty bad. So I wasn't able to, we had decided even before COVID that we weren't going to go back. We were going to do something different for our winters. But so the property there now has been sold, and we're finding it very different to be here for the winters. In many ways, it's a blessing because we're spending more time with our own little parish in Foam Lake. But we sure miss the warm weather and all the friends that we made in Arizona. And I find it, I guess, particularly difficult that we can't just drop in on friends like we normally would. We really miss going for coffee, playing cards. We used to get together after church almost every time to have coffee with friends and at one of the local restaurants or in someone's home. And of course, that's all out the window right now. And so blessed in a lot of ways, but certainly feeling the effects of the isolation, for sure.
Thanks, Garth.
I had not planned on traveling anywhere, but I will admit that life is much quieter at the present time. Not very much in terms of social activity. I hate to mention this in front of the bishop for fear that he'll call and ask me to do another presentation on something or other. But life is much quieter and much slower. The inability to gather with other people for meals, that type of thing. Ministry, very limited, given the numbers of people able to gather in communities, the time of funerals, that sort of thing. So it's much quieter.
With me, I'm just finding being alone, not as much. I miss the hugs. You know, I used to get probably about 300 hugs a day when I would work, and now I'm not getting those hugs. So I'm really missing that affection with all the men, and learning just to sit still and learn how to pray over a telephone. I never thought I could ever do something like that, just to sit and come up with prayers with different people that I don't even get to see their faces. But I just look forward to those phone calls now and meeting them on the streets. I can't hug them when I see them on the streets, and just trying to learn that balance and saying, okay, I have to put something between us. So I said, let's put prayer one day. I said, we'll put prayer. And the longer we spoke, I kind of went a little bit closer, but more than 6 feet. So it's been hard, but I'm learning. I'm learning just to cope with it and accept what's going on and know one day I'm going to get those hugs again.
And for those who are wondering, who are all these men in Diane's life?
Everybody knows I work in the group.
She's in chaplaincy ministry at the Saskatoon Correctional Center, and so which is largely a men's center. And she's a real spiritual mother to all of the residents there. So just to clarify. Well, Donna, how are you doing?
COVID has affected me in more ways than I care to know. Has tested me in more ways than I care to know. When I first got the call at home about work and not to come into work, because I'm one of the elderly people here, I was like, what do you mean? I'm not old. And I go, I'm in denial. I thought, well, this will be over in a couple of weeks or a month or whatever, you know, and we'll move on. Thought I didn't know it was going to be this long. But during that time to stay at home, that was the first time Pat and I had spent 24/7, day and night kind of thing, because he worked a lot of shifts over the years. It was an adjustment. Got to know Pat better. He got to know me better. Somebody had made a comment and said, well, this is preparing you for retirement. And I said, I hope not, because in retirement, I want to come and go as I, you know, random. It's cramped our lifestyle big time as far as coming and going and spending a lot of time with family and cousins and aunties that are in care homes and that. And I'm like Diane, I'm hugging. I love hugs. I love to not give a handshake when you meet somebody, even at the office, to me is rude. Like, it's been hard. It's been hard.
You know, as you reflect on the hugs, Diane, as well, and kind of how we've had to adjust to greeting each other and trying to be somewhat warm, even though we can't physically touch. You know, some of you, or maybe all of you know, I originally came from Vancouver, which is a very Asian community. And I remember when the SARS pandemic hit, You know, we all had to do the reverent bow at the sign of peace. And culturally, that was quite familiar to people who were from different parts of Asia. But in you know, for Caucasian people and other cultures, that was new. And so we had to adapt to a way of not touching and yet, you know, being intimate through learning from another culture's way of introducing ourselves and greeting each other. But I'm wondering, you've kind of commented on this next question, but maybe we could drill down on it a little bit more. You know, COVID-19 has broken out a lot through not only the urban, but the rural parts of our communities. I was speaking with Father Paul Ocean, for example, just a few days ago, and he's ministering in the Athabasca region from our diocese of, you know, of having gone up there to Fond du Lac and Black Lake. And Fond du Lac has had a huge outbreak, and they're kind of getting it under control now, but it's really affected the communities there. And we've heard of this in other northern and central provincial communities. So it's in the city and it's in the rural area. You know, maybe, you know, you and it's had a real impact on elders in particular, you know, and we all know that. I'm just wondering if you could say a little bit more of how the restrictions and other circumstances have affected you. And might you have any thoughts or insights about, you know, what you went through or still going through as a result of being more restricted and isolated?
Well, I can go first.
Okay.
My family's in Muscadet Reserve, and I haven't been there because can't go there, but they have, even there, you can't go in. They have security blocking the entrances so that you can't go visit them. Mm. And they're finding it very hard. So they're really isolating there. And up north too, I've got some families up there. And I was talking to one of my good friends, mom, because I needed an elder myself personally. And she cried on the phone and said how lonely she was, that no one could come and see her. So, and you know, I asked her, I said, how many people are sick? She said, a few. That's all she told me, a few were sick. And she had her grandson was sick. And she said she didn't like it because she couldn't go do any healing with it. So I'm finding that really difficult. You know, somebody will ask me to come and bring them smudge, and I can't go even sit and pray with them, because it's too dangerous for me either to go and sit, even though I have my mask, but I can't wear my mask when I'm doing my medicines, right, with the people in prayer. And I'm, the difference in working right now, like the men in the correctional center, I had an inmate crying because he was so scared. Mm-hmm. And the guy next to him had COVID, so he was being tested to see if he had it, you know, and no visits. Not even their family members. And I've been seeing some of the families outside on the street. And it's hard for them, you know, like it's Christmas is coming. And even personally for me, I always go there for Christmas time, and they're not even going to have a mass, you know, just like us, they're not going to have anything. So this year for their Christmas presents, they are allowing me to give out the gifts, but I can't deliver them. I have to bring them there. So I'm bringing them there this week. And then they're going to sit for 3 days and the guards are going to hand them out. And that's really hard on me because we always go and I have musical hats that I wear and we sing Christmas carols. And it's like, oh, it's not the same anymore. Christmas is going to be really hard Christmas morning for me. It was something I always look forward to.
Dianne, I'll miss the privilege I have as the, I think it's a privilege that the Bishop of Saskatoon has had for many years of being able to go on Christmas afternoon to celebrate Mass at the center. And so if there's any way we can extend to the residents there, just our prayers and our support in Christmas Day and in the season, please do so.
Yeah. I will.
The restrictions for us, for Pat and I, have had a profound effect. Because we had, Pat's mom was in a care home during this time. So we went from visiting regularly, which would have been weekly visits, going early in the afternoon, staying till late at night, once a week, to being locked down, to doing just phone calls because she didn't do Skype, to doing outdoor visits in kind of wind and rain weather, to being allowed in for compassionate visits. My first visit back in for compassionate reasons, it was hard. And it wasn't just hard seeing mom, it was hard seeing the caregivers, the type of care, they were really good caregivers. They're getting exhausted, they're tired. The people in the care home, it was like the life was zapped out of it, because they're used to people coming and going, and whether they got visitors or not, they at least saw other people, and there was just nobody around, and it was just so quiet. So that was very, very hard for us, very hard. Mom died on November 11th, and we were grateful that the care home had allowed a couple of us in to be with mom just prior to her death. And we were grateful that we had a funeral. It was very small. When Father talked, he said, you know, this church would have been full normally. And arranging a funeral, it was sad to think that you're afraid of the COVID, ugly COVID head rearing its head kind of thing, because you wanted to keep it small and intimate. But we did have somebody coming from out of the province in that, and it was a concern that this could be a place where, you know, we could be passing it on. To not have the hugs and to almost have a, you know, hold back from hugging and from the crying and from being there with each other as we should be, was very difficult. So I really hurt for those that have lost loved ones, and especially like the Dice family right now. Yeah, so many people.
Donna, you mentioned the Dice family, and so we're preparing to celebrate that funeral tomorrow at St. Anne's with Gail, his wife, and their family. So thanks for mentioning that. Gentlemen.
I think that Gailene and I are very fortunate because we live in a very a very rural setting, so we're used to being isolated. But I can, everything that people are saying about how this is affecting them, this pandemic, certainly rings very true for us. I think that we watch too much TV, and constantly watching, you know, bad news on about COVID is not particularly good for us. I've experienced depression for many, many years. And the effects of nothing but bad news day after day after day becomes quite oppressive. It's dampening. Dampening isn't the right word. It's hard for your spirit to accept day after day. And I really, this is trivial, but I really miss sports on TV, because that's one of the things that I really, really enjoy. And when you're isolated and can't, you know, do a lot of social activities, that's something that I really miss. And of course, the inability for us to go away. We were planning to go to British Columbia this winter because we weren't going to Arizona. We were going to stay in Victoria for a few months. And we have a daughter that lives in Salt Spring Island. So we were literally looking forward to, you know, spending more time with her and her husband and our grandson. And of course, that's all off now as well, because travel anywhere really isn't the right thing to do. So I just have to say that if it wasn't for prayer, I don't know where I'd be right now. It's been crucially important to me to maintain my well-being.
Garth, may I just say thanks for mentioning, you know, the struggle with anxiety and depression, because that's so pervasive. A lot of people are dealing with that in different ways and to different extents. And it's important to name and claim that in order to kind of, I think, help share it and move through it. So thanks for that.
I think all of us have mentioned something related to the fact that it's very quiet. And I have to admit that it's very quiet around the seniors' residence. And also quiet in the sense that on occasion I have helped out in a parish primarily with a small funeral. And it's really sad, not just simply that a loved one has died, but that only a small group of people, and I'm not challenging any numbers or anything like that. It's just very sad that such a small group of people gather together. There's no hospitality after. There's no gathering together in any way, shape, or form. And it's really difficult for people, and you can just see it in their eyes. And it's going to be that way for a while, and I guess we have to recognize that, and through our own spirituality and prayer, hopefully we can find a response.
Thanks, Father Ken. And I'm looking over at Dianne and Donna, and as we share our comments, they have intentionally put the word hope between the two of them. And so it kind of brings me to the next question, and that would be, many people are commenting that that while the pandemic has certainly altered their life and posed very difficult challenges, and you've all touched on some of those, it's also been and still is the occasion for some new learning and even some insights, and even inspiring possible changes in our lives. And so I'm just wondering if how this experience may be happening for you, and also any spiritual insights that you may be experiencing.
I can begin on that if I may. My parish has, for better or for worse, put me in charge of the list of who attends Mass each week. So I have emails and I have texts and I phone calls, and I have in some ways become so much closer to people because I'm in touch with them so much to see, you know, who can come to Mass that week, who can read that week, who can clean, sanitize the pews and such after Mass is over, so that the people that share the church will, you know, be safe when they come. And so it sounds like a drudgery, and people are always saying, oh, you work so hard, it's wonderful. It's actually a blessing for me to do that, to provide that service to our parish. I've also gained an incredible insight and appreciation into the role of our priests. I just have so much appreciation and admiration. This is really hard for our priests. They're in even more isolated than we are. We want to have them into our home and make a meal for them, and you know, we can't, or at least if we do, it's a very, very small group. We can't gather as multiple families and do that as we've done in the past. And I guess lastly, I could go on for an hour, but lastly, my faith has become, through this time, has become increasingly important. I will never, I hope, and I resolve to never take it for granted again. This is the rock that I cling to, and it's a very good thing that I have it.
Thank you.
I guess with me, it's the spirituality and the awareness. How much I need church in my life. I miss going and being with community. But community just isn't in the church now. when it first started, I was angry because I wasn't getting, I wasn't filling my cup, even though I was praying. And then I had to figure a way to do my job, right? To do my work. And because I couldn't go into the correctional anymore, and I was coming in here, well, everybody knows Diane's not a book person, and I'm not a computer person. Diane likes to be with people, especially with the inmates at the correctional center. So missing them was really hard. So I was starting to get this overwhelming feeling of anger, and I thought, oh, I can't do this. So I have to find a way. So It taught me how I can go to different places in the city and get my cup filled. And I don't think I've ever drank so much coffee in my life. But I can meet people. I've met them where they're at, and through laundromats, through libraries, sitting at a parking lot, and just being. And it's been so overwhelming. Like, I mean, the prayer, like I said, it's weird because people look at you and it's like, oh, well, this is fun, you know, because we're, and I have one that's just hilarious because he's great. He actually will yell out, hallelujah, amen, you know, while we pray. And he fills my cup so much, you know, and so I'm learning to, that it's not just in the parish, that it's among just being aware of your surroundings, of everything that's going on, and just letting that fill your cup through your own prayer and through others' prayers. Donna's good because Donna always will give you an email or a phone call. That'll fill my cup. So it's not just being in that community at church anymore. It's other ways. I'm taking that hope from there that I'm going to move forward through this time.
I find myself, given the fact that we're moving through this Advent season, perhaps reflecting more upon simply what it's all about, in the sense that it's Emmanuel, God is with us, and recognizing the presence of God in the people that we are able to associate with, and even in just simply so many of the small things that you normally or I normally would have taken for granted somewhere along the way. Just Emmanuel, this assurance that God is with us, and the Word of God tells us that, and it's confirmed in the people that we gather with, the people we meet, the people we speak with, day in and day out, even though there's fewer people that we encounter, at least that I encounter.
What do you think, Donna?
I think one insight I am learning, I continue to learn, is not to take the present moment for granted. That's the gift that we have been given, is a present moment. I think we can all look back and we can see times that we just took for granted, our loved ones or certain situations, or that we could just come and go as we please or whatever other. And no, it's a lesson that we need to appreciate the present moment. And we need to be there for one another in the present moment, whatever that means. I think also it has helped me when I look back in life, the dark times have been what have brought me closer to our Creator and to God. And that has been my strength, is faith. And also to rediscover our purpose here on earth. Are we here just to have a good time and to do, you know? Are we here to build community and build relationships? And because of our yearning of my loss of our relationships and not being in touch with people, it has really made me realize that our purpose is to come closer to our Creator, and God is calling us somewhere. The dark places aren't always our happiest places, but looking back there, God works through it, and we just have to trust.
Thank you. You know, if I may build on all your comments, and including Father Ken's little theological reflection there, I've always marveled at the call to the place that God puts us, particularity, you know, Pope Francis, in the recent encyclical Fratelli Tutti, talks about the local, the importance of the local. And I've been challenged and inspired with that during the pandemic. It's so ironic at a time when we're so able to be on top of everything seemingly in the world, at least via media and information, all of a sudden we're stuck and we're isolated in our particular place. And someone said to me the other day, you know, Bishop, I've really struggled with being stuck and isolated, but there's also a real blessing in this that, you know, having all these things that have piled up in our lives stripped away, you know, there's a real opportunity to look at my life as it is and to look at the most important relationships that I have in my family and certainly with my God and how I'm doing in that. And that really resonated with me. I mean, the wilderness has always been a big part of my spirituality, growing up in the coast and then serving in the north. And well, Saskatoon's a pretty big city, but pretty soon when you're going out for confirmations and visiting Foam Lake or wherever, you know, there's this expanse of big sky, and I've never seen so much land in my life that goes on forever. And, you know, so there's a blessing in kind of going deeper in that kind of recognition about the blessing of the wilderness and of being put in this place and this time and seeing God present in the simplest of things. And you've all touched on, you know, on some of those simple things. And so continue to be challenged and reflect on that. I can't help but think the celibates in this conversation may find things a little easier than others, but I'm not sure. You know, we all need relationship. And the COVID restrictions have kind of pulled away even the subtle little things we go to that aren't there either. You know, the relationship or the friendship that we would go to, or even the pastime that we could go to. You know, Garth mentioned sports. You know, even that's been affected, whether we're playing it ourselves or viewing it. But maybe we can move to one final reflection, in that, you know, Christmas is coming. You know, you can't stop Christmas from coming. I got a kick out of some of the people early on in public announcements that were saying, well, it looks like we might have to cancel Christmas. And I chuckled, you can't stop Christmas from coming. And then the Grinch figured that out. You know, so as Christmas comes, you know, I'm just wondering, how are you getting ready to celebrate Christmas? And any reflections about how the current circumstance will affect, you know, your disposition, your celebration of Christmas this year?
We were, as I mentioned earlier, we were planning to spend Christmas with our daughter and son-in-law and grandson in British Columbia. And of course that's been canceled. And, but I think, as I think about it and see Christmas looming, it occurred to me the other day, and I put this in my Christmas letter that I sent out to people, the reason for the season hasn't changed. And you rightly said, Your Excellency, that if people think that Christmas is canceled, then they really don't understand Christmas. Jesus is the reason for Christmas. And so what I'm doing and what I'm planning to do is to be more mindful of spending Christmas with Jesus. I won't be able to spend it with my grandson. And I know that Jesus is always there when I celebrate Christmas and every other day of the year. But this year, I'm going to try to be more mindful of that and aware of that. And I think in some ways that is making me look forward to Christmas Day even more than I normally would, which I know sounds incredible, but it is true. And so that's my disposition as I approach the beautiful Christmas Day.
Thank you.
Just from my point of view, I've noticed over the last number of years that I've been retired, Christmas is a much quieter time. I always enjoy being in a parish surrounded by many, many people. And that was always wonderful. And family almost seemed to be a side issue when you would find time for family because you were so involved in the parish. Now, given the fact that there's more time for family, well, this year it's just not going to happen. But in a sense, I've somehow become familiar with this is a quiet time. It's my time to reflect on everything that's been going on. and just simply to ensure that it remains that way. And I can't help but go back to that comment I had made earlier, that Gospels tell us it's Emmanuel, God is with us. And that's what we celebrate in all of the people that we encounter, whether it's family or parishioner or someone out on the street. Emmanuel, God is with us in and through all of these different people.
When I think of Christmas and reflect on it, I can't help but go back and think of all of Christmases we've taken for granted. The way we celebrated Christmas with loved ones and 10-minute mass and that, for many people, that was not and the joy we had. For many people in our world, that is not Christmas as they knew it. Christmas is stressful, not because we don't know what, they didn't know what to buy for their people, whatever, because many people don't have food for their table. They don't have toys for their kids. I would think the majority of the world have Christmas in loneliness or alone, or it's a struggle. It's a struggle. And it really made me think about what I've always taken for granted and remind me that I am called to share what I have. I know our charities, our churches are suffering to be more generous with the gifts that we were given and to share them more and to, you know, have extra people over when we can for occasions or not forget our neighbors, to be hope for others and to be a beacon of hope for others. And when you look at the first Christmas, I can't help but think of Mary and Joseph, the fear they would have had in their hearts of the unknown. And yet, be not afraid, the trust they had in God. It's a powerful time for reflection for me.
Well, thank you.
I don't know if I can talk. I wasn't looking forward to Christmas, but because I can't go into prison. And my first year without my husband. So I haven't been looking forward to it. But this morning my mom called me. And she's going to come sleep over Christmas Eve. So I'm going to have a sleepover with my mom Christmas Eve. And she's going to spend Christmas with me. So I have something to look forward to this year. It's been hard.
We've had a hard year.
I'll move forward. I'll take another step, just like everybody else.
Well, thank you. Thanks very much, Diane. And, you know, thank you all for your, not just your frank and your honest sharing, but the depth of your sharing. And I think you've named some experiences that a lot of us are sharing and going through. And so it's good to, as I said earlier, to name and claim some of these things. Because we can support each other in all of this. And it will be a different Christmas, a new Christmas. And as some of you mentioned, it may be kind of a rediscovered Christmas, the real meaning of it, you know, in the midst of this new circumstance. And in the midst of the desolation and the darkness, the light comes. And the greater the darkness, the more potent the light of the Lord. So, you know, I look forward to the intensity of the light, because as Father Ken said, God is with us, and it's good to be reminded of this at the Christmas time. So I'm wondering, thank you all, and maybe we could close with a prayer. And Father Ken is used to being put on the spot for a prayer, so I'll ask to close us in prayer.
We ask God's blessing on all God's people as we continue to journey through this Advent season, preparing our minds and our hearts to be open to and to receive the light of Christ and to extend the light of Christ to those around us. We ask for this blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, thank you all. That was a great sharing, and really, really appreciate your presence here. And blessings to you all as you continue to celebrate Advent and prepare for the Christmas season. And God bless you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Good.
Thanks. Bye.